Mark chapter number 2. That's where our lady will be today, from verse number 1. We start with a city called Capernaum. And we hear that Jesus now entered the city again. And one thing you have to remember with this city, because it's not just a city like any other. Capernaum was a village of Nahum. And of course, it's not related to the prophet Nahum today. So this city today is the one that is called Capernaum. And it's located in northwest shore in the region of Sea of Galilee. I want you to know which city we are talking about. So the meaning of the word Capernaum means the village of consolation or protected of being sorry. And when you talk about protected of being sorry, you have to remember that there is something that God will protect you today for not being sorry in the future. So that's the meaning of the word Capernaum. Or it also means the village of consolation. And this village was a 4 days distance from Jerusalem. So it was somewhere in the Sea of Galilee. But as I said, it's 4 days walk from Jerusalem. And the most significant thing with Capernaum, this city is also called Jesus' second home. Because even though that Jesus, he spent a lot of time in this city, and most of the miracles that Jesus performed, most of them he performed in this particular city. And also you have to remember that Capernaum is also the home of Peter. You know, so that's why it was very also a famous city. And this city or the village of Capernaum was also the home of the centurion soldier that one time that Jesus healed the servant. So you know what kind of city we are talking about. And now the Bible says that even though this city, the people knew Jesus so much and they spent a lot of time with him and they saw him performing miracles, he also spoke a very tough word on this city, because he said in the book of Matthew chapter number 11 and verse number 24, he said it shall be more tolerable to the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than the city of Capernaum. Simply because they had seen a lot of miracles. They have seen Jesus over there doing things. They were so familiar with him. But when it came to the time of belief, this was the city that led the other cities in unbelief. This was the city that even though they knew who Jesus was, they were familiar with him, they were also a very rebellious city at the end. And so, that's why Jesus spoke those very heavy words upon them. And the spirit of familiarity is bad, because there are times that we are so familiar with the church. We are so familiar with the word of God. We are so familiar with the ministers. We are so familiar that even when you read the scripture, even when the service is being, even when we come here to worship, you just say, oh, it's just the same way that we come, we worship, and we go home. We are familiar. And then you miss your moment of visitation. You say, I just coming, it's Sunday, let me just get up and go to church. You go to church because it's just a familiarity, it's just a custom of going. But you have to know that Capernaum was, Jesus spoke those words because he's saying that when it comes to judgment, Jews will be harder than Sodom, because you guys have seen everything that I've done over here. You have seen how much I have toiled over here. And yet, you are the same people. When it comes to them crucifying me, you are the same people saying crucify him. When you come to disbelief, you are there leading the way in disbelief. So that's the city that we are talking about. But now, this particular moment, we see that, you know, it comes that Jesus now entered again to the city again. So when he came, he went to the house. And in this particular house, the Bible says that the house, people, when they heard that Jesus came again, they all flocked to this house. That the house was packed with the people. Even outside was packed. So there was no room. But there's one thing that you have to remember. The Bible says that the power of God was present to heal. That when Jesus entered, the power of God was present to him. And every time you come to the house of God, I want you to know that every time you step into this door, the power of God is present to heal. The power of God is present to deliver. The power of God is present to change your situation in Jesus' name. Somebody say amen. Now, the Bible says that they came to the city, entered there, and Jesus started preaching and teaching the word. And when he was teaching the word, there was a man that was paralyzed, and the Bible says that four guys came in and they looked around and wanted to bring this paralyzed man to Jesus, but they could not enter. So what they decided to do something that was unorthodox. They decided to go all the way to the roof and destroy the owner's roof and bring, and they lowered the man down to Jesus. Amen. They destroyed the roof of somebody, of that house, so that they can lower the man. And there's something that is so amazing. One of the, I think it's NIV, it says that it was above Jesus. And that's probably the only scripture that you're going to find something that is above Jesus, because there's nothing else that is above Jesus. There's no sickness that is above Jesus. There's no stress that is above Jesus. There's nothing that you can measure in this world that you can see above Jesus. But the reason they say above is because it's not specifically meaning that the situation was above Jesus. It was talking that the kind of the level of faith that these four men had was way, way, way above. That when Jesus saw them bringing the man, lowering the roof, he was shocked. And you see, the reason that the man passed through the roof, it's because, number one, there was crowd. I want you to note that. Number two, there was walls over there. So they could not go through the cloud. They could not go through the wall. And I was asking myself, wasn't it easier for them to just cut through the wall? But when they cut through the wall, the cloud will go through the wall. So there's no way they can be able to access. So these guys, they thought about it so much for them to go through the roof. So the walls, of course, the purpose of the wall in a building is to support the roof. It is to support the floor, is to support the ceiling. It also provides shelter and security. So that's what the walls does. And so they could not be able to go through the wall. So they decided to go through the roof. What is the purpose of the roof in a building? The purpose of the roof is to offer protection, so that you can be protected from heat, rain, and snow. That's why you see we have the roof. Now, they decided to go through the roof. The preacher that we have here, we have Jesus preaching, we have room that is packed with the people, which is the crowd. And we also have another group that had come from Jerusalem, which I told you is 4 days walk, which were the scribes, the masters of the law that were seated there listening to Jesus. And they were there. And now we have four men. These four men, when I was reading the word, I was thinking, were they maybe Kenyans? Were they African? You know, some of the way Kenyans will look mambo ya kienyeji. I was just thinking, maybe because the way they were thinking, the thinking was probably like an African way of thinking. That we have to access this man to Jesus. And we don't have to follow in the order here. Because the protocol was for them to come through the house. They have to come through the gate. They have to come through the door. But these guys, their work was, I have to make sure that I get this man to Jesus. And all the one thing, the way I'm saying this, probably was a way of African way of thinking. There's no concept that we said that was signed by this man that they have to bring him to be healed. We don't hear any conversation. All we hear is the preaching was going on, the teaching was going on, the crowd was there, and all of a sudden there was a commotion that they hear somebody on the roof coming down, and they heard a mark, they are bringing the man, lowering him to Jesus. Hallelujah. So when Jesus saw their faith, oh my God, he was moved by the faith of this man. The question is, are you like the four men that you look at people who are perishing out over there in the world, and you say that even though I may not be able to preach to you, I'm going to carry you and bring you to the house of God and just leave you there. You may not do anything else, but God has equipped you with the technology. God has equipped you with anything. And sometimes all you need to do is to invite somebody and tell them, let's go to the house of God. Sometimes you don't need to preach to them. All you need to do is to give them an invitation. That there is a conference going on. Can we attend? All you have to do is to tell them that there is a movie that I saw about the Passion of Christ. Can we have a date and watch that movie together? All you have to do sometimes is to tell them, can we have time so that we can be able to attend a fellowship together? Or what are you doing this Sunday? Can I pick you up so that we can go to the house of God together? So there were four men that they saw the pain that was of this man, because he was paralyzed. Meaning that even when Jesus came, there are so many people who came from other cities and they left him there. He could not be able to walk himself to the house. He wanted to be present in the presence of Jesus. He wanted to come and be in the front row, but he could not do it by himself. But there were four men that were helpers. There were four men that they were genuine. There were four men that were able, they were saying that even though we break every protocol, our work is to bring these men to the house of God. They knew the consequences. They knew that they could have suffered. They could have been stoned when they were breaking somebody's house. But this man, they said that for the sake of this paralyzed man, let's bring him to the presence of God. Amen? So they did that. So what do you do in the house of God? What do you do in your life? Remember we talked about as a leader. As a leader, you have to know that every time you look at people, you have to see how you can lead them to Christ. How you can lead them to Christ. God has given you influence. God has given you capacity to impact other people's life. Can you impact them and bring them to Christ? Amen? Amen. Now, there was the roof. And I want to talk about the roof for a little bit. What is the purpose of the roof? I say the purpose of the roof is to offer protection. And even in the house of God, we all need to have a roof. We need protection. And faith is part of our roof. When you believe God, you need to have faith in you. And when you have that faith, even though things are not working very well, when you have faith in God, you have protection. Amen? When people are dying, you just tell God, God, I have faith in you. I need that protection. I need to be covered by thee. So that's what the roof does, is to protect you. Roof is to protect you from bad things happening to you. Also for Christian, it is important for you to have a roof. And that is what we call the home church. A place where you know that this is a place where I am protected and I am under the umbrella of a church. Some people say that I don't need to have a home church. Today I can go to this church. Next time I can go to this church. And next time I can go online and they say, you know, I'm still a Christian. But the thing is, you need to have a place of protection. You need a coverage. A roof is to provide a coverage. If you are talented, if you are a singer, if you are a doctor, you need a place where you can call your home. A place even wherever you go, you come back and you know that there is a protection for you. And the anointing that is happening in that house, the word that is spoken in that house, will make you prosper in Jesus' mighty name. Somebody say protection. That's what the for us as Christian, when you go deeper, that's what protection is all about. That even though you are not in the house today, even though you are not in the church, you know that you are attached to that church. You are protected in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Now, also another thing with the roof, it also adds beauty to a building. When you see, that's why you see different designs of the roofs. So when you have a roof, there's a design, there's a beauty that is added in your life. So you see some houses that they have a roof that you look at it and you look at it again and you look at it again and you're like, wow, what happened? It's just a beauty. You know, the perfection of it, it makes beauty, it adds beauty to the house. But now, there's also something else that I want to talk about with the roof. The roof also represents limitation. You are limited by the roof. If you look up here, there's a roof. We are limited on how far we can reach our eyes because the roof brings limitation. And so what these four men realized, if we break the limitation of the house, we'll be able to lower the man to the presence of Jesus. And I pray that every limitation that has been set over your life, every rule that has been set over you, may it be broken in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Rule represent limitation. What is a limit? A limit is a point or a level where something does not go beyond. A limit is restriction. A limit is a line that is drawn that your mentor believe you cannot go past it. That's a limit. So you are limited. And there are so many people that want to excel in life, but there is some limitation that has been set over their life. I pray that this morning, may you discover in the presence of God every limitation that has been put over your life. I don't know who built your roof. I don't know who put the limitation over you. But there are people who have walked all their life with a limitation. When you feel limited, you feel discontented. When you feel limited, when you're limited, you feel intimidated. Because this, you want to go far, but you cannot go far. When you are limited, you feel insecure. Because there's a lot of insecurity around you because you want to move, you want to do something, but you are limited, you are insecure. When you are limited, you feel inadequate. Yes, you want to speak. Yes, you want to bless somebody. But you are inadequate. You are limited to resources. You want to change people's life. But you feel limited. There's inadequate. You want to post something online and bless others. But you feel inadequate. You feel insecure because you don't feel like them. Limitation. When you are limited, you feel unappreciated. And there are people, ever in their life, they are always complaining. They feel like they don't appreciate me. They don't see what I do. They don't see me. You feel insignificant because you are insecure. There's something you feel. You feel so limited. When you are limited, you are always in the offensive mood. You are always ready to defend. You know, when you are always in an offensive mood, you want to attack because you feel insecure. When you are limited, you also feel offended easily by others. Because sometimes you don't even know what's happening. When people are celebrating their life, when people are busy doing their things, you are just thinking, maybe they are talking about me, maybe they are thinking this about me. So you feel so offended by others. But it's because you are limited. I pray that this morning, that we may come out of that limitation, every limitation that the devil has put in our life. I pray that you may break that limitation. And that's what these four men saw. They saw a limitation. That this man was paralyzed. He needed healing. But there was a limitation that was set. So they decided to do something that was not orthodox, so that they can bring him to Jesus. So when you're limited, the devil attacks your faith, that you want to move, but the enemy knows that there is some limit. He tells you that yes, you can believe God for this healing, but remember this and this. Remember that others are dying. Remember that COVID is killing people. Remember that this thing that is happening. Remember that your grandfather died of this sickness. So even though you have faith, he limits your way of faith. He limits the level of thinking. And that's what the enemy does. So for me, when I tell God that, God, in this season of new beginning, Father, I pray that God, you may remove every limitation that the enemy has put in the name of Jesus. I pray that the enemy, when he comes to my life and speak to me, I'll tell the enemy that I have faith in Jesus. I have faith that I can intercede. I have power to break and to rebuke him in the name of Jesus. I have power to break every limitation that the enemy has set over my life. I have power to speak things, and this will happen in the name of Jesus, because Jesus is in me. I have power to pray over this church. I have power to pray over members. I have power to pray over families. I have power to speak things in my children's life. I have power to lead me to break every limitation that was set. Oh, you say that, Pastor, you know, I feel limited because every time I start a relationship, it doesn't work. And I'm telling you that even though that the first one that did not work, you have the power to break that limitation in Jesus' name. When you say, I feel limited because my education level was up to high school, and the Lord says that he can use anything and he can use you. He doesn't need your diploma. He doesn't need your degree. He needs your availability in Jesus' name. And you say, Pastor, oh God, I know that, but every time I stand in the presence of you, I feel judged because of my past. And the Lord said that he is not concerned about your past, he is concerned about your future. He is concerned about everything that you are doing today. He is concerned about how you are able to break that limitation and move on in Jesus' mighty name. Limitation is when you are stuck in the past. Limitation is when you're stuck with the word that were put in your life in the past. Who put your roof? Who is that came and put a hedge over your life? What are the words that were spoken over your life in the past and you've been hanging on to them? Are there some limitation in your family that when you try to penetrate and when you try to have a breakthrough, you feel limited? Jesus says, this season, I am here to break every limitation in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Somebody just lift up your hands and say, God, I break every limitation that the enemy has put on my life. Come on, speak to it. Speak to those limitations. You know your limitation. You know what the enemy has limited you. You know the area that you feel limited. Oh, you feel the area that you feel limited. I want you to speak to those areas in the name of Jesus. You have the power and authority to speak over them. You have the power and authority to break them in Jesus' mighty name. You're going to soar higher when you break that limitation. Hallelujah. Amen. Let me talk about the four men. These four men, again, I said they have a spirit of lion in them. They had a spirit of lion in them. That this day they said, he is here. He is in the house. And he has the power to heal. We are going to test everything. We are going to break every limit and bring this man to Jesus. So number one, these guys, they were risk takers. Hallelujah. And life requires you to become a risk taker. If you have to succeed in life, you cannot succeed without taking risk. If you don't take risk, you're going to be limited. Oh yeah, that's how we operate. You've been doing this for years. Yes, you're going to be limited to those years. You say, oh pastor, you know, yeah, this is how things are supposed to be done. But you got to become a risk taker. These guys were risk takers. Number two, these guys were movers and shakers. They were moving and shaking things in the spirit. They were moving and shaking things in the physical. Nobody have ever sung a worship song in America who is a Kenyan and the songs trend. So we are not going to sing in English. Just continue, stick to our life of Kikuyu. But there are people who are movers and shakers. You bring the worship and you bring it to America and let them worship the Lord. Amen. They come and say, standing here, you feel I declare that those worship songs will be sung by churches in America in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. We are movers and shakers in the spirit, and God is not limited. Amen. These guys were men of faith. They were men of faith because it took faith for them to go and break somebody's roof. And it took faith for them to know that if we bring him to Jesus, something will happen. Amen? And I commend you guys because you are all people of faith. Coming to the presence of God. You say that, God, I know that house, you see, sometimes because what we usually do, we look at the church and say, oh, the church is for people who are saints. This church is not for saints, and churches are not for saints. A church is not a museum of saints, but a church is a hospital of sinners, like me and you, who come here and drag themselves and say that God, all I need is to go to your presence and just seek you. And when God look at your faith, he come and blesses your life. Amen? So these guys were men of faith. And these people, even though they were men of faith, they were also men who were full of compassion. Because you can be a person of faith and have no compassion. But you see, when Jesus was healing people, one of the things that every time that Jesus was healing, this one is mentioned a lot, that when Jesus looked at them, he was moved by compassion. When Jesus looked at the people, how they were hungry, he was moved by compassion. So compassion comes hard in hard with service and seeking God. As you say, I have faith. But the question is, do you have compassion? Do you have compassion on the people that you are praying for? Do you have compassion on the people that you are leading? Do you have compassion of the people that you always talk about? Do you have compassion over them? Do you have compassion over your family? That even though you see them being lost, you're not going to hate them, but you're going to have compassion over them and pray for them and help them the way you can be able to help. There are men who are full of compassion. It was easier for them to just come and attend the service and experience and celebrate the love of Christ and to see Jesus teaching in their city. But these men, they said, instead of us sitting down there, they were compassionate about a man that was paralyzed. So they said, we better just go bring him. We then went out of their way. Amen. The generation that we are living in is a generation that do not understand that word, going out of your way. And that's what we call sacrifice. Going out of your way. And if you want to succeed in life, that is one of the components that we have to have. Yes, I know we are going to excel in our education. Yes, I know we are going to excel in our finances. But the question is, are you able to get out of your way so that you can be able to help somebody? Because if you do not do that, what you are doing, you're also putting a limit in your life. But the minute you go out of your way, that's what we call sacrifice. Going out of your way. So these guys, they sacrificed their comfort to come and sit in the service so that they can bring men and change somebody's life. For you to change people's life, you have to sacrifice your comfort. Amen? And I know comfort is really good. Comfort zone. Comfort zone is beautiful. Comfort zone. That's why it's called comfort. It's comfortable. Comfort zone is good. Amen. It's comfort. Do you know coming to church is a sacrifice? Do you know serving is a sacrifice? Do you know interceding is a sacrifice? Do you know praying and fasting is a sacrifice? Even learning new songs is a sacrifice. Liking songs is a sacrifice. Serving others is a sacrifice. Giving is sacrifice. And you know how much hard it is to earn money in this country and even all over the world. But when you give, you are sacrificing. But the opposite is bad than sacrifice. Because if you do not sacrifice, you remain in your comfort zone. And when you remain in your comfort zone, your comfort zone will keep you where you are. But when you sacrifice, you are paving a way for your future in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Somebody say sacrifice. Hallelujah. Then this man, they were men of vision. These guys were visionaries. They came up with a plan. They said, God, how are we going to take this man to Jesus? We cannot go past the crowd. We cannot even borrow permission to go there. So they came up with a vision that has never been seen. They were visionaries. May you become men and women who are visionaries in Jesus' mighty name. Amen? And do not confuse sight and vision. Because you may have a sight, but no vision. You may have sight, but no vision. So don't confuse those two. A sight, as far as you know in this house, everybody have sight. Because you can see me. And some of you have great sight. 20/20. You can see a needle even where it's here in the pulpit. But a vision, it's when your sight is closed, but yet you can be able to see something that is there. You can be able to see where you are going. You can have a roadmap of your future. That's a vision. But when you have two and combine them together, have a sight and have a vision, then you're going to go far. Amen. So there are men of vision. What is the vision for your future? What is your vision for your children? What is the vision for this church? What is your vision for the service? Because also the service, you have to have a vision for the service. How are you going to serve God? How are you prepared to serve? You got to have a vision. And these guys, four of them, they were great leaders. We talked about leadership last Sunday. But these guys, they brought leadership because there was a lot of coordination that was going on. There was a lot of thinking. There was a lot of cooperation that they were cooperating so that they can be able to bring that man to Jesus. And the Bible says that when they came and they brought him to Jesus, Jesus saw their faith. And then when he saw their faith, he looked at the man that was sick. And then he looked at the guy that had come from Jerusalem, who are present to make sure that this man is teaching the right doctrine. And the Bible says that Jesus of a soul in the spirit what they were thinking. They didn't say it. If it was Jesus who saw the what they were thinking. This is when you have the Spirit of God. Sometimes you are able to see what people are thinking. So that's what Jesus said. He was just sitting there and he saw what they are thinking. And I know what you guys are thinking right now. I can see what you're thinking. Because the Spirit of God reveals. So he saw what they were thinking. And then he looked at them. They were saying, oh, you know, because Jesus looked at his human son, your sins are forgiven. And they started looking at the theology and they see this man, he doesn't have the power to forgive the sins. And they didn't even say, Jesus said, this is what you are thinking. I said, what is easier for me to say? That your sins are forgiven, or to tell this man, rise up, get your mat, and go home. What is easier for me to say? And when the man had those words, the power of God went through his body. His bones were strengthened. And he woke up and he looked at Jesus. He looked at the crowd and they paved the way for him. And he looked at the law givers and the law teachers that were there. And he woke up, he took his mat, and he went home. Praise the Lord. And the Bible says that the people in Jerusalem and Judah, that we have never seen something like this before. So when God takes you from your level to another level, there will be a testimony that will be seen in your life. That people will say that we've never seen anything like this before. We have never seen songs like this. We've never seen revelation like this before. We have never seen a man like this before. We have never seen a young man that has excelled like this before. We have never seen God elevating servants like this before. It's not because of the amount of money they have. It's not because of their name they have. But it is because of the power of Jesus. And this morning, I pray and declare that the people will have the same testimony over your life. That people will look at you and they will say that we have never seen anything like this before. Amen. Let us all lead that fast again so that we can make it in our life as we enter. What did they say? They said, immediately he rose up, took up the bed, and went out in the presence of all of them, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, we never saw anything like this. And that is the song and the testimony that people will always say over your life. When the Lord provides for you supernaturally, they'll say, we've never seen anything like this.
Amen. Oh, surely, surely the presence of the Lord's here. Oh, surely, surely the presence of the Lord's here. Oh, surely the Lord is here. Oh, we'll be right back. ni Mungu wewe.